We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Sitting in the morning sun, I'll be sitting. Watching the ships roll in,
then I watch them sail
then
away.
Then I watch them roll away again. Yeah. Sitting on the dock of the bay.
All right, good afternoon. Welcome. We're back another Saturday.
Yes, we are. Yes.
Trench Talk.
Yes. Sitting on the dock of the bay.
That's my retirement song, just so you know. That's the first thing I'm putting in the CD player when I get out. So again, I want to thank everybody for tuning in and listening in. This is Trench Talk. This is like a dream come true show for me. This platform is to support our veteran community. I wanted a place where our soldiers could come, service members, men and women could come and share their military experience, share their stories, good, bad, and indifferent, and then provide resources and information, find out what they're up to today. So I want to thank my guest today, Rodney Henderson, for coming on the show and being open to share who you are with the community, with the world, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you. Make sure you put the mic up a little so you can it's directional.
Yeah, they are directional mic. They'll speak into the mic.
Yeah. So how we got connected is my teammate Jody met you, and you guys shared information, and next thing you know, he's like, I got a veteran for you. I want to talk to you, and here you are today. So introduce yourself to the listeners, please.
Yeah, I'm Rod Henderson, that was one really good day when we met Jody, the wife and I and our barber friend, and we had a blessed time,
yeah.
I'll tell you.
And thank you for blessing him with that day, too, as well.
That's well, really, he blessed us, too. So you can't do anything with the Lord and just be one-sided. It's always
exactly. Yeah, you have to have the Lord in your life. As when we're young and foolish, and we don't realize the power of the Lord.
Exactly.
Some get that opportunity to know the Lord at an earlier age. Myself, it took me a minute. But once I started another relationship with him, man, things just been like amazing.
Mine was kind of odd because it's grew up in a religious atmosphere, and then understanding it's a relationship after you're older was like, man, I was going away too long. So
I was like that too.
It's great to have that spirituality connection.
Yeah, I believe we all were lost sheep at one time.
Yes.
You know, so that we can learn. I believe that he wanted us to experience certain things so that hopefully we'll get back and we find our way, you know, knocking my head up against the wall a few times, and then I'll be like, okay.
They call it spiritual beings in a dirt suit.
There you go.
So Rodney, please, let's talk about who was Rodney before you joined the service, man? Who was Rodney as a kid?
I was one of three brothers. My mom died when we were... when I was 12.
Wow.
And my father was a good man. He raised us. His sister came and helped raise us. He became our mom for a while.
Wow, that's awesome.
So we've always had a really good life. He was raised in Louisiana on a farm. He moved out here. So we've always had enough of everything.
Now, being 12 and your mom passing away, how was that? Like,
that was a major pain in my life.
Yeah.
I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't get used to it, you know. And... I guess it's taken me years to kind of get rid of it.
Did you feel you had to be responsible at 12 years old? Like, you know, had to put your man pants on?
No, because my dad was really, he worked, provided for us. He was there. He wanted us around.
Yeah.
He didn't let us go around, so we didn't get to.
So out of the three, where were you at?
I'm the oldest.
You're the oldest.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Okay.
Awesome.
My other brother's LAPD, retired, and the younger brother's an awesome mechanic.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah, I need a mechanic.
So how was your teenage years growing up, you know, in that environment with your aunt?
You know, they were pretty normal.
Yeah.
People always looked after us because we were super polite. Our parents trained us like that.
Yeah.
And I find that people really do things for you when you're like
that. Yeah, they will gravitate to you when you are, you know, polite.
Yeah.
Sincerely polite, not false politeness. Yeah. You know, that, you know, I'm only being polite to get what I want, and then once I get it,
But that could be a good mentorship program, introducing that back to our youth, because that's something's missing right there.
That's another reason for teaching your kids to be polite.
Right.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Definitely
something missing there right now today. Yeah, it is.
They be wilding out.
And it might, one of my favorite pictures is The Blind Side.
Yes.
What I like about that is that young man, even though he was in kind of dire circumstances, he decided in his mind that he was going to be different.
Exactly.
And the same with the rich family that took him in.
Exactly.
Even in their environment, they decided they were going to be different.
And lives were changed in that story. Exactly. Definitely.
And kids make those decisions very early in their life, and you have to make sure that
we make bad ones too.
Yeah.
Is that the one with Sandra Bullock?
Yeah, exactly.
A true story.
Exactly. Yeah. A true story. So what had you join the military?
Yeah, his wife over there laughing like,
here comes. Well,
we should get the wife in here to get the true story.
How about before we go to that part? How about what were you up to before you joined the service?
Nothing much. I was an artist, kind of. That's all I basically did, things like that.
Music artist.
Yeah.
Painting.
High school. I was just a common kid. You know, I never was big shot on the basketball team or anything like that.
Yeah.
Carried my little books back and forth every day, but my classes weren't that great. I don't know why I did it. But my parents were really good, and they stayed with us and didn't allow us to do any crazy stuff.
What instruments you play?
Guitar.
Guitar? That's your
name. I broke my cousin's guitar, and so he gave it to me, so I fixed it.
You fixed it and started playing it? Because it wasn't broken, huh?
No. So then I was going to college, LACC.
Okay.
2 years, and...
what year is this? What year?
This is 1960. I graduated from 65 from LA High School.
Wow.
So that was another thing. That was the kind of high school that was, you know, they weren't upper crust black kids, but, you know, it was a
decent environment.
Yeah,
a lot
of Orientals, a lot of some Jewish people and stuff too. So
yeah. LA High was prestige.
We got beat up at the football game.
Oh, okay.
By Dorsey.
Manuel.
Oh, Manuel. Oh, yeah.
Jordan, Jeff.
Yeah.
We were the only ones that would leave the game when we were winning. Leave early.
Bus rocked and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I remember that. We weren't those hip kids, you know.
Yeah.
So anyway, I was going to LACC. I dropped down to 12 units. And I got my greetings letter. So,
and so your greetings letter for everyone is the draft letter.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it.
What was it like when you opened up that?
It was kind of devastating, but I just felt like everybody else was going, so I wasn't going to duck it.
Yeah.
You know, you stand up and take your medicine, so to speak.
Like that, yeah.
Yeah. So.
What did your family say about that when your dad shared?
You know, they were a little sad, but my dad was in World War II and everything. All my uncles have been, I got some Tuskegee Airmen in the family.
Oh,
and
wow.
All that kind of stuff. So it was just a natural thing to just listen to them and go for it. So they told me to come down to get my physical. And I honestly thought they were going to let me come back home and think about it for a while.
Now, how old were you at this time when you got the letter?
Gosh, I was 20, I think.
About 20 years old at the time? So you had did a little college already, so you was...
Yeah, and so,
So no physical?
Everybody said, look out the window, they got buses, and they were warming up. I couldn't believe it. And we got on the plane. I thought I was grown, but, you know, the tears were coming. I looked over, there was the Playboy jet right next to me, and I thought, oh, Lord, all the good times are gone.
Oh,
I think
God.
All of us cried on the way over there.
So the physical, you went in for the physical, you thought, but it was actually...
And it just snatched us, yeah.
Everything was that one day, introduction and outro.
Yeah, and you know
what?
How it is. As soon as you hit the cam, you ain't off yet.
Yeah, wow. Right, exactly.
No crawling on the ground, your good clothes and all
of
that.
Of course. What was you thinking when you heard that? When you heard
I
that?
Just couldn't believe it. You know, Fort Bliss, Texas. Hot as heck, and it was an experience, but we just bucked up and took it. But I laugh at it now. It's a bunch of guys crying and stuff. Crying was going over to Vietnam. That's what.
We're gonna get there. So you're on the bus, off the bus. The group of guys that you were with, what was that experience like for you?
Being guys around? From all over California, all different races and stuff like that. So it was kind of hard because I don't like to, you know, authority. I deal with authority pretty well, but when they talk to you like dirt, then I don't.
Back then they could get away with that.
Oh yeah.
Today is a little easy. It's a little different today, but then I'm sure it was.
It was hard.
Yeah.
Then they made me platoon guide.
Oh.
And that lasted about 10 minutes. And it said, Henderson, when you got your stuff together, the men ain't together. When you got their stuff together, I mean, you know, vice versa.
Right, right.
So I was just a regular guy. That's all.
So had you been around, I guess being in college, you've been around a lot of different people, but that military crowd, that community is a little different. What was it like like for you in meeting guys?
I thought it was kind of good. I mean, they kept you busy all the time. I finally figured out that nothing you do was going to be right because they wanted you to all be just alike each other.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
No matter what you say, you were wrong, and they build up your body. Low crawls, you know.
Oh, yeah. Because I remember one time I did so well in sit-ups because you had to do like 50 in 60 seconds to score 100. I did like 55. You know what I mean? I was really going.
Yeah.
So I was just nonchalantly doing my sit-ups. The drill sergeant was like, wait a minute. Just because you scored 100 points don't mean, you know. So he had me like lay on my back on a slanted hill and make me do sit-ups, you know what I mean? Yeah. But they don't want you to make you, you know, give you the idea that because you excel.
Right.
That
you know better, you're not exempt.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Not exempt, and you know better than the next guy.
And I swear, when they cut your hair off, you all look alike.
Right?
White, black, you look alike.
Yeah. Well, I kind of tailored mine a little bit down. Well, they still try to take it off.
I lucked up because I didn't have to. They looked at me and was like, leave me.
I told my dad, give me a ball fade. Just give me a little ball fade. And when I got there, they was like
Article 15 if we did anything different.
Yeah, when I got there,
they said you're military property, so anything you do, if you let your feet get rotten,
exactly,
whatever,
government property,
you're in trouble.
You're government property. No, you no longer own yourself.
Yep, that's what government issue, GI.
Your transition. I know for like myself personally, I know it took me about 3 weeks to transition from civilian to that.
I think it's
routine.
The same.
Well, how about you?
Yeah, I think it was about the same.
About 3 weeks.
I don't remember
it
because it's something you want to forget. You know. I just remember that it was rude for them to make you eat real fast, and then you had to run back.
Right.
You know, and I was always getting in trouble because I didn't want to do that. And you get up so early in the barracks, you have to be out front. Almost in your underwear. Then you have to get back in there and clean up the whole place before breakfast.
Let's talk about the meal. When I came home from AIT and I sat with my parents to eat dinner, it was like...
They were like, slow down.
My mom was like,
what? Load up.
Like, what? I'm like, Mom, I'm sorry, but we used to have to eat like 6-course meal in 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Like literally you have the main meal, fruit, salad, dessert, and drink in like 3 minutes.
But they feed you fairly. I like the way they fed
you. I gained 20 pounds.
Yeah. Even in Vietnam, you know, in firefight, they stop bringing the Marmite cans and you sit there and eat that and they, while they're mortaring you and you go back to fighting. So
How was your basic training?
Basic training was kind of rough for me because of the way they did things. They had this one little sergeant. He was a little guy, a Puerto Rican guy. And he was one of those guys that didn't make it, but they still had him in there.
Oh.
So sometimes they'd call him over to watch the guys while the drill sergeant went somewhere else.
Oh, okay.
And I swear, I used to look out the window. As soon as he was in charge, I could see him talking to him. And then next thing I know, they were hitting the ground.
Yeah.
That little guy, he was just there to talk.
Well, usually they said the little guys, they always want to have something to prove anyway.
Yeah.
Because of their size.
But we used to mimic the sergeants. That was fun.
Yeah.
All of them had a voice that they made up.
Oh, yeah.
And
I used to
love the way they say things.
Yeah.
Distinct voices, too, huh?
Yeah.
I can go downtown, mess around, break. You try that, you'll destroy yourself.
Yeah. We had one that always like to chew tobacco, and it's one of his one line is, "God damn a bear, God damn a bear, you damn trainees." You know what I mean? Then we had one sergeant, we called him Dent Head because he had a metal plate in his head Vietnam. But he could sing his behind off, man. And he'll get you in the mood of singing some cadence, boy.
Right, right.
That's what I hated.
You hated singing cadence?
Yeah, because we had some lame stuff. But you had to sing, and then come on, you better sing around her neck.
Yellow ribbon.
You don't sing, we're gonna run around her neck.
Yeah, the yellow ribbon.
Double time. Next thing you know, you were running.
Wow. Yeah, so. And where did you go up to? You said Fort Bliss for your
basic, and then for Tigerland, Fort Polk.
Fort Polk
for the AIT.
How was Fort Polk back in the 60s, man?
Yeah, it was strange. It was strange. I liked it because my folks are from Louisiana, my father is. But it was something else, I tell you. I loved it, though.
What MOS did you take? I
was 11 Bravo.
Rifleman. Yeah. So what was that transition?
I was a kid that grew up. My dad was a carpenter, so I would take all his wood and make my own rifles and stuff.
What?
So when I got drafted, I kind of thought, you deserve it. I was always, I knew about the burp guns and the Brownings and all that. I used to draw pictures of the Mitsubishi Zeros, and then I knew all the planes. I knew all that stuff.
So you was ready.
Yeah, I kind of felt like I deserved to go.
Yeah, so you can pick a wing off a fly, huh?
and could identify them. As 11 Bravo, that's key.
Yeah.
Because you have to be able to identify those planes and tanks and things like that.
Yeah, yeah. I know all the U.S. stuff. I still know pretty much the new weapons, the old weapons, and how many guns they had on, what type of guns, and that type of stuff.
People think that 11 Bravos, because it's the infantryman that is like, you don't have to score high and all that. But those guys are intelligent.
Oh,
to
yeah.
be able to read a map, to be able to go through those maneuvers, identify. I mean, that doesn't take.
Well, I'll put it like this.
Especially today. Dumb job. Yeah,
exactly. But I was going to say, if I had a choice of who I want to share my foxhole with, there's an infantryman.
Yeah.
Because they know how to survive.
What I liked about it is no matter what you did, if you were the cook, you were a lerp or something like that.
Yeah.
When it came time, they took away your jeeps, they took away your pots and pans.
You got a rifle.
The rest of the guys.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's like the basis of every soldier is an infantryman, because you have
to
be able to shoot, communicate, move on out.
Right.
Exactly.
And I love to play war, but this was a little
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And those instincts never leave you because. Well, earlier this week, I was coming from Long Beach City College, and I got to the Red Line, and when the train came up, something with either a metal or a rat or something touched the third rail.
Wow!
And boom, the first one said boom. So now everybody they looking. Then the second one, boom, boom, and the smoke. And
explosion.
It was an explosion, right? So, how the comedians say you don't have to tell a black person to run. once they see people running, it was just like that. They start running. I'm gonna talk like Forrest Gump. They were running, and my instincts was the marquee, the width was wide enough for me to stand by. So, I was like that, you can't see me, I'm off camera, but,
right.
But I'm standing like, and I'm like, I'm looking.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Because people running like that.
You terrorist attack, you thought?
But people running like that, somebody could have got pushed onto the track on the other side,
trampled
and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, what military taught me was observe your surroundings before you move.
Right.
And don't move hastily.
Look for that next position to go to.
Exactly. You know what I mean? And fortunately,
cover.
It wasn't
no
terrorist attack or anything like that. Something hit the third rail when the train came to the stop.
I like that too.
You know what I mean? But people were running. I sort of took a picture.
We call it scary. We were scary. We were like that from the time we were kids.
Yeah.
Brothers and I,
Yeah, so.
We don't just run with everybody else. We check it out.
And I have to say the military, because of the training that they give you, never leaves you.
Oh, man.
Yeah. It just automatically kicks in, and then you know.
It does. It served me well over in Vietnam. I'm thankful for the training.
Yeah.
Even though
at
the time.
It doesn't look like.
No.
It looks like, what am I? Did you ever have one of those mornings or one of those nights that you're looking up at the ceiling like, what am I doing here?
Yeah. I think the worst time was to eat lunch after you've been working out all day and laying on them hot rocks and exercising. You eat lunch, and then they send you to the boring Universal Code of Military Justice.
Class.
Okay? You had to sit there and listen to that stuff, and you couldn't go to sleep.
The Z Monster.
Yeah.
When the Z Monster shows
up. Close, you'd hear this ruckus off the side. They were dragging some guy screaming. He had to go out, and they made it seem like they were killing him.
Don't fall asleep. Don't fall asleep.
We call it the Z Monster.
The Z Monster
get on your back.
That sitcom used to be back in the day, Gomer Pyle.
Yeah.
Well, I had a drill sergeant had a buzz haircut like that, and we was in one of those classes, right? So why did I turn around? I turned around. He started going off, and the drill sergeant next to him had to calm him down. So that even made me more scared.
Oh my gosh.
Good cop, bad cop, kind of like.
Man,
you know how they do.
I didn't know. You know, I'm 19. I didn't know. I never turned around.
What's your most memorable experience in between basic and AIT in the training?
Oh gosh, I don't know. They were a lot.
Did you ever get smoked?
A lot of memorable.
Did you ever get smoked?
Oh, the gas. Yeah. CS gas and the chlorine gas.
Yeah.
That wasn't too much fun. I think one of the most one was escape invasion.
Okay.
I know at Fort Polk they have a little Vietnamese village, and you sit up there in the bleachers, all of you, and then they talk to you what you're going to go through, and they said, so are you ready? Yeah. Are you ready? Yeah. They get you all hyped up. Are you ready? And then boom, boom, boom. Everybody's ooh. You know.
We not ready.
Yeah, ready. I know. Yeah.
So they give you this chicken for about 30 guys, and they said, go ahead and cook it, you know. And so all these guys are grabbing at the chicken trying to cook it, you know. And so they're going to ball up newspaper and stuff like that. I'm one of these, like on The Odd Couple, the one that does everything right.
Yeah.
Oh, no, let me do it, you know. I had the Boy Scout, you know, with the sticks.
The sticks. Rubbing the fire.
And all I got was a drumstick. So they cooked theirs their way. I put mine on the regular way.
Right.
Theirs was beautifully brown until they touched the skin.
Oh, right.
Then we had to run for it. And I didn't know which way to go. All of a sudden, all these guys, there were about 10 black guys. They were running, and they were holding hands. And they were kind of going sideways and stuff. And they grabbed mine, and then off we went, you know.
Where were y'all going?
Into the bushes. But if they caught you, they tortured you, you know.
Yeah.
The train, that was part of the training. Yeah.
You could hear the guys hollering and stuff like that. And
what?
You know, as you walk, there's a bunch of leaves, and you slip down and you fall down behind each other. It sounds like people are chasing you. So we really got it. And that kind of tickled me. That was like a real deal.
Yeah, I remember that because they had something like that where I was stationed at, but where. No, they get you while you know doing your regular job, and then no, I don't care what kind of rank you have, they just walk in, snatch your ass, and then they torture you.
Like done, been, right?
Yeah, like you're a prisoner of war.
Y'all had it crazy back in the 60s and 70s. Huh?
Yeah, but just when we got drafted, they had stopped. They couldn't be really abusive to you.
Yeah, exactly.
So thank God.
Yeah.
So what I went through, I couldn't imagine what they went through before me.
Wow. Yeah.
Punch them and everything.
Yeah. When I went in, they calmed down a little bit. They still were able to do certain things and you know, they can snatch you by the collar and that kind of stuff. I don't think they can do that now.
My time in the late 80s when I joined, they would just smoke you. You would, I mean, wet t-shirt contest. Yeah. I mean, the dog walk, the dying cockroach, the flutter kicks,
the
flutter kicks.
I think the dying cockroach has always been in the military.
Yeah.
You see a guy laying on his back with his arms and legs up there, and they're just shaking, and he's crying, and grown men crying.
Dying cockroach.
Yeah, I'm a dying cockroach.
The turkey walk, they had, what do they call it, gorilla stomps.
Yeah, I remember gorilla stomps.
You had to do weird stuff.
Yeah.
The mountain climber? Y'all remember the mountain climber?
Yeah.
What, and the telephone poles.
Woo! What about just having your weapon and just holding it out there?
Oh, boy. Yeah.
Try holding that out there for 10 minutes.
But and the duffel bag drills.
That was good training for me because when we got to Vietnam, you know, you see the guys jump up and fire and they ain't like that.
Right. Hell no.
You stick your weapon over the
thing. Now we're going to get to that. I want to take a break. You brought a song. What's the song? Because we're going to go into
basically, it's called, I get two of them. I get mixed up. It's just talking about how you serve your country.
How you serve your country.
You know, it's talking about the people who complain about the soldiers, you know, that we fight for that right.
Right.
You know, and all that type of stuff.
So can we play that song on the break? We're going to go to break with that?
Yeah, we can go break right now.
This is Trench Talk. This is Ryan. What was your rank?
I ended up Sergeant E5.
Sergeant E5. So we're here with Sergeant Henderson, prior Army veteran, Vietnam veteran. You're going to share your Vietnam story, some of that, with us after the break. All right, this is Trench Talk. I'm your host. I'm Sergeant First Class, retiring Sergeant First Class, Ferron Dozier.
And Specialist Fourth Class, Veneric Marshall.
This is Trench Talk. If you want to call in and have any questions for us, 323-247-7443.
We'll be right back.
When your country beckons and is under attack, you just grab your weapons and you don't look back. You never give up.
Never give up.
Tell the enemy fold.
Tell the enemy fold.
And it don't matter if you're hawk or dove, when the ones that's dying is the ones you love. Together we rock.
We rock.
And united we roll.
United we roll.
We're hated and feared by those we oppose, cause we're cutting down terrorism wherever it grows. Stop dissing the president, cause he's our CO.
He's our CEO.
And we are peaceful people. I can tell you up front, if you're planning something evil, we can bring it if you want. We united for the national defense, because united we roll.
United we roll.
Ain't looking for a reason to fight. But if you're plotting, you're in our sight. Together we rock.
Together we rock.
And united we roll.
United we roll.
Together we rock.
Together we rock.
And united we roll.
United we roll.
Your anti-war groups have a right to expression, thanks to the troops who fight to protect them. Don't bruise their morale, they're just doing what they're told. We got the best armed forces in the best country, and they ain't in the war business for the money. They're proven and proud, and united we roll.
United we roll.
Don't care if you're left or right, when the troops deploy and we're tight. Together we rock,
rock, rock,
and united
rock,
we roll. Together we rock.
Rock, rock, rock.
Yeah, united
rock,
we roll.
All right, welcome back. This is Trench Talk. I'm your host. I'm Sergeant First Class Ferron Dozier.
And I'm Specialist Fourth Class Veneric Marshall, and we're our special guest.
We've got a special guest. Introduce yourself.
Rod Henderson.
Sergeant.
Former Sergeant Rod.
Former Sergeant Rod. So
what made you come up with this, you know, song for Vets?
I actually had another song that I won an internet song contest with Janet Fisher, who used to be a country and western singer.
Wow.
And she had and I won first place. So they put that song on an album with 11 other people from across the nation. really good artists from all different styles of music.
Wow.
And so mine's the first song on there. So when I went on this show in Oklahoma to talk to them about it, they were having a contest for the name of their show was Together We Rock, Unite We Roll.
Oh, wow.
So I wrote that song for it.
Wow.
But it just didn't work out. But the lady who was had the other song told me that that was the song for the show, but for some reason they
didn't use it. That's okay.
Yeah,
man, thank you for bringing that and sharing that with us. That's huge, man. That's huge.
I'm a big kid, very, you know, drama stuff.
right
We got DBC over there. Was it you like that, DBC? Yeah, he got thumbs up.
Thumbs up.
So we're gonna take it, we're gonna kick it up a little bit. You're done with your training at Fort Polk. You get the call to go overseas. What was that?
Yeah, it was I didn't cry on the outside, but inside I was crying.
Yeah.
But, you know, their favorite, you know, my favorite line is when I didn't want to do something. Well, what are you going to do, send me to Vietnam? Well, finally, I was going to Vietnam.
Yeah.
So we went to see our folks, and then we just boarded the plane. But on the plane, it was a very nice passenger plane and everything. They were playing To Sir With Love at the time. I don't know why. That made everybody cry. We just thought we wouldn't see anybody.
Right.
And a lot of people didn't.
Of course.
Come back.
Unfortunately.
But we landed there and wasn't no trouble when we went to training. But then all hell broke loose after that, of course. One song that I was in Hawaii but couldn't stay because we landed in Hawaii just long enough to make us sad again.
No kidding.
I didn't even get to stay here. Wow. You know, I'm going off to die, you know.
No.
Very dramatic.
So when you landed there, the training, how was that different from what you learned through basic and AIT?
Well, first thing we landed, like we're in this fancy, I don't know, was F-1011, one of those jetliners. And we seen all this smoke coming up and stuff. And we thought, mortars, you know. And they did mortar Tonson Newt, but not then.
Yeah.
You know, so we're jumping and doing everything. They were burning waste.
Oh, wow.
So then they put us in the training camp in Benoit, and then they sent us off to our units.
Yeah.
So I was sent to the 25th Division, 4th of the 9th Infantry.
Okay.
Manchus. We had to grow the little mustache.
No kidding.
And every time we were in the jungle, and then when we come back, some guy who didn't have to go out there would make us cut them off.
Real bad. So you growing your mustache, you're cutting it off, growing back.
That's the only thing we had is the mystique, you know.
Right.
They were trying to. That's why I wrote the song for the guys in Iraq, because I remember that all you got is a song sometimes.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, music marks a place in time.
Yeah. And it unifies us too. You know?
Exactly.
And everybody knows that you fight over there for your buddies mostly.
Exactly. You know? So did you have a battle buddy? Like, who was your?
No. You know, over there, when you make buddies, they're not around too long.
Yeah.
So it was the strangest war because you couldn't have a pattern. You know, if you ran away, you got killed. If you stayed, you got killed. If you were, you know, no matter what you did, you know, there's no rhyme or reason.
Right.
Thank God that we only had to stay a year each.
Oh, okay.
We had to go back.
Yeah.
Because I know World War II and the Korean War must have been really rough.
Yeah.
But still, it was pretty rough. We were near Tainan City, up near the Triple Canopy, and that's where the NVA tried to take over at that time.
Yeah.
And I arrived in country just in time to spend a month or two before the Tet Offensives. So it was, it was kind of weird.
I'm quite sure, that experience, and again, you're still a young man in your 20s, early 20s, experiencing all that. Yeah. So, how did that affect you? If we're not going too ahead of ourselves, affect you when you got back?
You know, it was a while before I was adjusted. My dad would come in the room and say something to me. He said I slid out of the bed without moving the covers.
I know. Yeah, man.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Yeah. I believe it.
And rolled over. He said it a couple times. I grabbed my little brother on the street when the car would backfire. You know, stuff like that. But really, I was good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's the other guys that to this day I was supposed to be going to see him and stuff. You know, and we had started too, but somehow we dropped the ball.
Yeah.
And I wanted to let them know about the Lord because that's the thing that kept me straight. I didn't know the Lord at that time.
Yeah.
But I went to church and everything, and I had this little Bible in my pocket.
Yeah.
Because of that song where the bullet stopped the Bible.
He was like right there, right?
Yeah, but looking back, the most astounding thing, I thought, Lord, if I had to die then, I'd be gone forever.
Wow.
You know, I'm just now kind of seeing that.
Yeah.
So he looked out after me.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But I had this, I could do anything, jump every, you know, at that time.
Yeah.
So
how did you deal with that mentally in that environment? Like, did you have an outlet?
I hate to say it was a horrible place, but I was kind of in my element in a way.
You know? Oh, yeah. They make you, because I'm going a little bit back because, you know, TV with these military movies give you the idea that it's John Wayne, up, da-da-da-da. Yeah. Like you said, you like this.
Yeah.
You ain't aiming because you may be an expert shot, so is your enemy.
Yes.
He can also pick a wing off a fly's back just as well as you
and
can.
And we learn to respect him really quick.
Really quick. I met a gentleman.
Mr. Charles.
Yeah, I met
Mr. and Mrs. Charles.
There you go.
Started on VC, then it was Mr. Charles.
Mr. Charles. I met a gentleman at this hospital I worked at, and he was missing a thumb. And he said, he was in the Vietnam era war, and he said at night, he struck a match because he was about to smoke a cigarette. He struck the match and a sniper shot at the light.
Wow.
It took his thumb off.
Wow. And he said he was about to put the light up to his face. And if you'd have had the light up to his face, he would have got shot in the face.
Yeah.
My point is, you got guy, and he was like 300 yards or more away. And because they tell you that if you want to smoke a cigarette, you take your poncho and you put it over your head. And you smoke that cigarette underneath your poncho because that light.
They looking for any indication.
Exactly. And you got Charlie, Mr. Charles, 300 yards away that can pick that off.
What's one of your, if you can want to share, what's one of your most memorable events during your stay?
There were a lot of those over there. I was feisty. I didn't like the way they talked to me, so I almost went to Long Bend Jail because I didn't carry the machine gunner's ammo with me one time. And another time I got left, we were in the triple canopy, so every day some helicopters came to take you out, or you walked out and you came back in the helicopter, but every day you had to go on patrols. You had to look for the enemy.
Right.
And then building bunkers, I have so many. I was one of these... I don't know if you call them anal retentive. No, don't build it that way. It's got to have the proper, again, the crisscross thing.
Yeah.
So they got tired of listening to somebody let me build a bunker.
Where did that come from? That sounded like that came from a childhood, some kind of childhood experience.
He said his dad was a cop.
My mother was carpenter. Sharp on everything.
Your mom was sharp. Yeah. Okay. So it had to be.
And then his dad was a carpenter.
Right. So he built it. I'm a builder.
He was a Louisiana country man, too. Carpenter and farmer.
Right.
And the mother was well trained, and she could do archery. She was clay modeler. She could cut hair. She was a piano teacher. She was a piano player, a high school teacher. She knew German.
Wow.
She was one of those. Trying to stand up and be what the race should be, I guess.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Good at that. In fact, we knew Martin Luther King. He was a friend of their family.
Wow.
Cool.
But me, I guess I took a lot of that in. I was always kind of different.
Yeah.
And I thought I was weird, but the Lord has let me know that this is me.
That's
this
just you, right?
There you go.
So I don't apologize anymore. But over there, I was decorated a couple times. And those are the most memorable. One time we were getting ready to cross a bridge, and our Charlie company was late, so we were going. And here they come running past us.
Oh, my goodness.
And they went down the line around the bushes, and we heard some firing, and we thought it was they had contact. And when we went over there, it's near this high bridge, a short high bridge that went over a little stream. And then it turned the corner right after the bridge, and there was a plantation where the trees, you're up on the road, you can't see under the trees.
Right.
And so we ran over there, a squad of us, and we saw guys on the bridge and didn't pay much attention to them.
What?
And we went down the embankment. We thought they were in the bushes, and it was the enemy, bunkers and everything. and they were firing at us, RPGs and everything. So I felt somebody kicking me. I was just getting ready to go around. I was always doing something crazy. And the guy kicked me, and then the whole squad was gone. So I ran up. So we, like they say, your back feels about that wide.
Right.
You feel like you can't hardly run.
Right.
They were firing 50 calibers and everything at us. So we got on the other side, and we were pulling out for airstrikes. And then one guy said, hey, Doc, what about the guys on the bridge? So we had this great medic. He refused to carry a weapon because he didn't want to kill people, but he was always the first one out there.
Wow.
And he went back, so me and the other guy went back against orders. And finally, the lieutenant had, he was new, he had to let the whole group go.
What?
So we were on one side of the bridge, and me and another guy went up to cover the dock.
Wow.
And he began pulling the guys off the bridge, so we crawled out there.
No
way. And they
were
firing at us and everything. And then we had a firefight, and we found out that all the guys were around the corner laying out on the road. The ones that ran off the road, they were claymores.
Oh, my gosh.
The rest of them was, I was walking across the river, and we were stepping on guys that I just played basketball with.
No way.
A couple of days before that. So it was really sad.
So they ran right into the trap.
Yeah, 50 guys.
Yeah.
Wow.
So then we went back over and assaulted, but the enemy were gone. And then the same day they gave me, out in the field, they gave me the Silver Star. We went into a place where our lieutenant and a few guys got trapped in the field. He was killed, and we went to rescue them again. And that was more comical, but I got decorated for taking out a bunker.
Wow. There.
But it was one of those kind of things. We had this officer. He could do everything. he was just like Sidney Poitier to me. You know, he Lieutenant T. And he said, who's going to follow me? And I said, I will. You know, I'll follow him anywhere. And so about three of us. And I'll take the lead. I run. I hit the ground. You know how your helmet comes over?
Right.
You just know the enemy's looking at you. My magazine comes out of my gun.
What?
You know, and I know if somebody was right there, I'm dead. So finally, they catch up with me. We're in this little field with scant bushes, just a few sticks. So we're laying down. Let's go. So we jump up and run. And then the other guys cover us, you know. And
yeah.
Get down. Then they jump up and run.
Right, and you cover.
Then we get to the edge of the field. And he said, let's go. And he jumps up, and we jumped up. They fire. We get back down. He runs out. So we didn't see him anymore. And I was really.
No hurt. Way.
I was getting ready to crawl around the side. And then somebody said, no, he's back here. And what it was is a bomb crater out there. He fell in the bomb crater, and he said he got stuck down in mud. He could just picture the NBA rolling the grenades down on him.
Oh, my God.
He said, so he struggled. He's real hot. He struggled up. He got top, and he says he heard this distinct snap. And you know what they say about that. That's the back of him shut up. He said he ran. His back felt about that wide. And he made, so he had us laughing.
Oh, my God.
He'd have us out in the middle of the field with enemy around us laughing. He's going to get his kill one day sooner or later.
Wow.
But then I got decorated with a Bronze Star for that.
Wow.
And okay. Later they gave me a bronze with a V, bronze without the V for service.
Wow, congratulations.
As a squad leader.
Right.
That's
right.
Awesome.
Yeah, that is congratulations.
That's history, man.
So I thought about that. Decorated, you know, three times. No shot, no Purple Heart. I knew that had to be the Lord.
Yeah.
I just couldn't believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually thought I would die when I got back to the States because I should have been gone, you know.
So your injury, I see you have a cane. Did you get injured while you was in the military?
They took me in for some kind of checkup, and they said that I had cracked my knees.
What?
Jumping out of a helicopter. Hairline crack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it bothered me off and on during the years, but when I finally got to the VA, they wouldn't allow it because so much arthritis and stuff. But they do give me stuff for Agent Orange.
Okay.
So they didn't cover your knees, though?
No, they didn't cover the knees.
But what?
I think it stemmed from over there. Yeah. We were always.
We got to talk about that because that
Yeah. That's one of the things about Trench Talk, you know, with the benefits that's out there and the programs that's available for us. We inform one another.
We got to get that looked at for you.
Yeah, exactly.
Sure.
My main thought about it is that I don't really trust our government nowadays.
Yeah.
And I don't want to try to get anything more from them when they look like they're throwing our money away. It doesn't make sense.
Right.
You know, they don't want to give us the Social Security, I know.
Yeah.
And so I'm not going to bother them with anything else because then they get nosy.
We respect that too.
We respect that problem. I hate to say it on the air, but it's what I really believe.
No,
no problem. No problem. This is one thing about Trench Talk and LA Talk Live. There's no censorship. The subjects we can talk. We can talk our true feelings.
Yeah.
But I want to also know how when you and your significant other met and how that was.
The lovely Shirley Henderson.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, were you in the military when y'all met?
No. After I got out, I went to work for Bank of America at the data center.
Wow.
And after I spent about a year there, I met her.
Wow.
Okay. Okay.
She was beautiful. She was walking up there. I remember seeing her. I had a girlfriend. We just had broken up, and I was kind of sad. But when I saw her, I lit up. One day, I saw she had three little kids.
Wow.
And so I was selling these little cheap pictures that I painted with grapes and kind of like a still life.
Yeah.
So that was my excuse to get over to the table where she was and try to get her to buy those.
Right.
It was a bunch of ladies, but I wanted to talk to her.
Wow.
I found out she wasn't married, and that's when we
had that conversation.
Yeah, I was brave enough to ask her for dates.
There you go. And the rest was history, huh?
Second best move I've ever made in my whole life.
Wow.
Was to ask her to be my lady.
Wow.
My wife. And the first best move, of course, is Jesus.
Of course. So I want to, if you can, we got like 10 minutes left or so. Transitioning back from being in Vietnam to back to being a civilian, how did you transition that? Like,
I was a little lost for a while. I went back to school. I'm the only guy probably is never graduated from, what do they call it, junior college? 3 years at junior college.
Right.
51 point degree grade.
Point average.
Efficiency.
Right. Okay. Oh, okay.
So, but I'm a researcher. I look up everything. And as I get really old, to keep my mind sharp and stuff, mm-hmm. I start researching.
Researching.
I found out some fantastic stuff about the world, about the Word of God, about myself. And these past 2 years, it's been wonderful.
I'm
like a child again.
That's awesome.
But we raised a family of six.
Wow.
You know, and they're wonderful kids. Everything's turned all right. And we lived in Compton all this time.
Wow.
And it was only the Lord that, you know, let that happen.
Because I know some soldiers, some service members say, you know, with the PTSD issues that are going on, having those experiences, like being able to file those experiences, really like file them in the past where they don't affect your future.
There's only one way to do that. That's with Jesus. No man can take that out of your mind.
Yeah.
And I've seen it again and again. My friend was a sniper over there. He did two tours over there. He was with the Air Force and joined the Army afterwards. And he's been up the rivers. He's been everywhere. He's shot people through the scope and everything. And he told me he was afraid that he liked killing people.
Wow.
He used to roam around in the Watts in different places looking for troublemakers.
Wow.
You know, he was, we talked about it, we prayed about it, and the Lord took that all away from him.
Wow.
Yeah, the power of the Lord, man.
Yeah. And people can't do it because people can't really get in your mind. They just mess you up.
Yeah. The mind is powerful.
Yeah. They want to regress you. That doesn't do any good. I used to do prison ministry too.
Okay.
My church.
Right.
And we'd come in there and talk to them about the Lord. And that's about the future.
Right.
And they would change. I did a drug and alcoholic fellowship for a while.
Wow.
I've seen miracles in there just every time.
So it's really a conversation with that. And we were talking, I went to a couple of meetings this past week as far as PTSD. Like, and even homeless veterans, like, you have to look at that person's life even before the military. Like, what kind of lifestyle that they grew up in. Because some guys join... And they're like, man, you went from the frying pan to the fire. Like, your environment from your home was worse than being in the military.
Exactly.
So I think that it has a lot to do with each individual person and having a conversation about, like, what their life was even before the service.
Yeah.
So we can find out their thought process. You know, I think a
that's
lot of homeless
all,
is.
It's all good to know. I mean, you have to know what's going on. But the fact is, the Lord doesn't give a hoot about the past.
Yeah.
He got a future for you. He can change it.
Oh, yeah.
The sad thing I've discovered is most of the people that I believe have ever lived on the planet will not be going with him. It's a very few will be going with him. And that's why every chance I get, I'm trying to let people know you need to pay attention to what the Bible says. You need to pay attention. You need to find out if he's real or not,
yeah.
You know, because it's a total choice. It is a choice. In fact, I think that's our whole purpose for living is to choose him or not.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's so, all that. That's that free will.
Right. So no matter you try to help a person with sickle cell or with mental disorders or anything, it still has to come down to
their choice, right?
You want to live forever or you want to suffer forever?
Yeah.
So
that's huge.
Good point.
And that's
good
what
point.
I'm doing now. I'm writing now. I've discovered some things that I believe will prove God's existence. And
anything in the veteran community that you care about that you want to you've done some ministries in the
yeah
in
I
the
joined
prison.
The VA hospital finally after all these years
yeah.
And I'm interested in maybe working with some of the guys down there, but it's hard for me to get around because I got the bad kneecaps.
Yeah,
so that's what I care about. I have friends who are dealing with the MIA situation.
Okay.
Oh, one interesting story, make it real quick. There's a guy that I work with. I became a draftsman, a petrochemical designer and that type of stuff
okay.
for many years. I worked with this guy, and we were talking about Vietnam, and we just happened to keep talking about close events. And he told me about this sergeant his brother rescued, his body, actually.
Okay.
And I said, I carried that sergeant.
What?
To find out I was carrying one arm, his brother was on the other arm. We carried uh-huh. across a log bridge and different stuff like that. He had 3 terms over there. He would go out and kill people by himself. He was like a little gone.
What?
Because he shot some people in his home and then gave him a choice of prison or Vietnam.
Wow.
And when he got killed, we carried him back. So I met his brother, and we were over there together.
No way.
So the 3 of us became, we had just accepted the Lord. And we would do all kind of wild things. We'd go to the VA right. and stand out front and hold hands. The Lord said we could have the 3rd floor if we could hold hands out in front of those people. Yeah. You know?
Okay.
Are you
and
serious?
We would go talk to the pastor. The pastor would let us do the service. And finally he said, you can go anywhere you want to. Because in the VA, if you're a Catholic, you have to go with the Catholics.
Right.
You know, and we want to talk to everybody. But
right.
then somehow we dropped the ball. I don't know what it was.
Wow.
But I think I've done as much crazy stuff since I became with the Lord as I did over Vietnam.
Yeah,
you know, I go to gang members in Compton, start talking to them. They look at you. The ones that didn't want to hear would leave.
Right.
The ones that they would accept the Lord.
Right.
I couldn't believe I was doing those things.
Wow.
You know, stop knife fights. And there's little gun battles in front of my house, you know, all kind of stuff.
Wow.
So now I'm thinking, which was worse, Vietnam or
interesting.
Yeah, you know, he has us put in certain battles without us realizing until after the fact.
Exactly.
Yeah. Because I was in a battle as a property manager at 80th and Broadway. And before I went there, people that was living here was like, oh, man, you better be careful, man.
Yeah,
it's about 4 gangs, different gangs in that one area and all that. But he took care of me.
Yes.
And I turned that apartment complex totally around.
Wow,
where they,
I believe you.
Where the, you know, the gang members, when they did come see their families or friends and all that, they act accordingly. Like I told them, I said, well, you know, if you want to fight, take it outside, because if you fight in my building, I'm kicking you out.
Wow.
So if you want to get kicked out, fight. If
so
you don't,
you joined the real army.
I joined the real army.
You joined the real army. You
yeah.
fight for people's souls in their lives.
Exactly,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah,
because I got them from throwing trash and pumpkin seeds and sunflower seeds on the ground in front of their apartments to picking them up.
And they respect that.
Exactly.
They respect that.
Exactly.
You don't go in there by yourself, but when the Lord is with you, when the Lord tells you, you can go, you can do some incredible stuff.
Exactly.
I've seen drunks sober up as I talk to them. You should go down to Skid Row and just talk to them and
right.
people to
the Lord. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I've seen all kind of miracles. I've seen legs grow out. My wife's leg was healed like that. Grew about an inch. It was healed.
Wow.
As we prayed.
Good.
You know, so.
Yeah. I threw a.
I've seen everything.
Yeah, because I threw a 4th of July. Philadelphia style block party, and it was such a success. There was no violence, you know,
yeah.
the any gang members
it
who
was
there. Yeah, and, you know, they came through, you know, and you know, they ate and drank and had a good time, you know. I even paid the children, you know, gave them a couple of dollars for cleaning up,
yeah,
you know, stuff like that.
Do you think that your military training, now that you've committed your life to serving, all those, that courage, all that, do you think that pays?
Yes.
Has a part in your.
I think whatever you are and whoever you are, the Lord takes that and uses that.
Definitely your experience.
Got something different for everybody.
Yep.
And anything man can do for you, the Lord can accentuate it and use it for the real cause.
Now this is not playing the stage. You met Jody just out of nowhere. You have sickle cell trait.
Yeah.
That's one of my other causes. When did you find out that you had the trait?
Years ago, yeah. I found out my dad had it, so I had to warn my kids and stuff to, you know, make sure that they didn't marry.
Now, after I had my exertion injury, I found that soldiers in the 70s had been collapsing and dying from exertion from sickle cell trait. Did you ever?
I never heard that, but lately I have been wondering why doesn't the sickle cell affect me? It must be affecting me somewhat. The doctor told me I was anemic. Then he called back and said, no, it's my sickle cell. And I'm thinking, well, then if my cells are sickular too, even though I don't have the disease,
right,
must be doing something for me.
Yeah.
So when I heard you guys show, I was really, it was kind of like
Yeah.
You know, and the Lord's been showing me a lot of stuff with healing and stuff, with natural healing,
right,
and natural things. I don't trust the pharmaceuticals too much anymore.
So me and Rodney got some work to do, not only in the veteran community, but outside in the streets, in the community as well. Hey,
don't you have something on next Sunday?
Monday.
Is that Monday?
Monday show.
No. I'm talking about I got a text from you about you being at the Marriott.
Oh, no, that's the obesity. I advocate for a lot of things. And that's,
okay.
That's the fighting obesity.
I need to go to that being an audience.
Well, I'll share that with you. There's a partnership that I have, and our campaign is to fight obesity.
Yeah, that's my struggle. That's some of my struggle.
Then I can definitely.
Yeah, because I can't move much. My legs are gone. The cartilage is gone.
Yeah.
And they won't operate on them because I'm overweight.
Yeah.
So how do you exercise if you know, so
exactly.
I go down to the pool, swim on my back, those type of things.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we got lots of work to do.
I got things to do, yeah.
Thank you for coming and sharing what you've shared with us on Trench Talk.
Enjoy both of you guys, all three of you guys.
Anything you want the veterans community to know about?
Just like when I got a chance to talk to them, I just want them to know that I don't care what you hear. You got to look up Jesus. You got to join his team. He'll take
Amen.
Care of you in any kind of situation. And all that stuff we really want, longevity and stuff, that's the real deal. He will give it to you.
Yeah.
I'm fixing to come out with a story with the thing showing that the black hole in space is the lake of fire.
Whoa.
And it's something they can't get around. I'm using the scientist's own testimony along with what I know about the Bible.
Wow.
And what that means is that one of God's creations is right out there for us to see.
Wow.
And it's the worst one in the world.
Okay.
Wow.
So don't play the game of just existing through life. You want to look up. You want to find out where you're going after you
and
die.
And live your life, right, too, right?
You don't want to take no chances.
There you go. Thank you.
Now, we got like a few minutes. I don't want to not push it off, but you said that Agent Orange was something that you're dealing with. How is that?
You know, I haven't been affected much at all, except I had prostate cancer and surgery.
Okay.
And so a lot of people say that's related.
And the VA is taking care of that? You take care of that?
Yeah.
That's good.
They'll give me a little money for that. But I've already had the surgery. I'm clean and everything. And
good.
I'm fairly healthy.
Good.
Well, again, I look forward to doing lots of work with you
thank
in the
you.
Community.
I do too.
And again, thanks to Jody.
Yeah.
That's my man right there for speaking out and sharing our passion and our work, community work. So
exactly.
I'm
glad I met you guys.
Thank you. Once again,
that's it, man.
Yes.
Man, next week I have a female Marine, prior service Marine, coming on the show next Saturday here on Trench Talk at 13:30. So you want to tune in for that. She's going to share her military experience as a woman in the Marine Corps. So she'll be here next Saturday. And you can catch me Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time on WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live, streaming live, community outreach show. Man.
Yep. And coming up next is the Van Eric Rock Show. I got a couple of artists, European artists, Skyping in and calling in. One from Australia, and I think the other one from Switzerland, I believe.
Whoa.
It's going to be calling in, and I'll be playing some of the hottest classic rock music. So stay tuned.
It's LA Talk Live, man. We're more than just talk.
That's right. Exactly.
All right. Exactly. Thank you for tuning in to Trench Talk. We'll be back next Saturday, 1:30 for you civilians, right here Saturday on Trench Talk.
That's right. Don't get no too confused there. You heard it. Thank you.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, there's far too